सादर नमस्कार आप सभी सम्मानीय जनों का। मैं ब्रह्मदत्त सिंह, अधिवक्ता, मध्य प्रदेश उच्च न्यायालय जबलपुर एवं मंत्री अखिल भारतीय अधिवक्ता परिषद महाकौशल प्रांत, इस ऑनलाइन स्टडी सर्किल की श्रृंखला के इस एक और कार्यक्रम में हार्दिक अभिनंदन करता हूं, स्वागत करता हूं। जैसा कि आप सभी को विदित है कि आज का यह कार्यक्रम स्वर्गीय श्री पी सदाशिवन नायर साहब, वरिष्ठ अधिवक्ता, मध्य प्रदेश उच्च न्यायालय की स्मृति में आयोजित किया जा रहा है एवं आज के हमारे मुख्य वक्ता माननीय न्यायमूर्ति श्री राजेंद्र मेनन साहब रहेंगे, जो कि वर्तमान में सशस्त्र सेना अधिकरण के अध्यक्ष भी हैं एवं पूर्व में दिल्ली उच्च न्यायालय के मुख्य न्यायाधिपति, पटना उच्च न्यायालय के भी मुख्य न्यायाधिपति एवं हमारे मध्य प्रदेश उच्च न्यायालय के कार्यवाहक मुख्य न्यायाधिपति के रूप में पदस्थ रह चुके हैं। आज माननीय श्री मेनन साहब द्वारा सेवा न्याय शास्त्र एक अंतर्दृष्टि, दैट इज एन इनसाइट इनटू सर्विस ज्यूरिसप्रूडेंस के विषय पर हम सभी को संबोधित कर हमारा ज्ञानवर्धन करेंगे। इस कार्यक्रम में हमारे बीच में उपस्थित हैं श्री दीपेंद्र सिंह कुशवाहा जी, जो कि मध्य प्रदेश उच्च न्यायालय ग्वालियर खंडपीठ में अधिवक्ता हैं एवं हमारे अखिल भारतीय अधिवक्ता परिषद मध्य क्षेत्र मंत्री भी हैं। मध्य क्षेत्र में मध्य प्रदेश प्रदेश एवं छत्तीसगढ़ आते हैं और श्री कुशवाहा जी के मार्गदर्शन में, निरंतर मार्गदर्शन में हमारे द्वारा यह स्टडी सर्कल का आयोजन किया जाता रहा है। हमारे बीच में उपस्थित हैं श्री ज्ञानेंद्र सिंह बघेल जी, जो कि अधिवक्ता हैं मध्य प्रदेश उच्च न्यायालय के जबलपुर मुख्यपीठ में। वे अधिवक्ता परिषद महाकौशल प्रांत के अध्यक्ष पद का भी धारण करते हैं। इस प्रक्रम पे मैं और समय न लेते हुए कार्यक्रम को आगे बढ़ाते हुए श्री बघेल साहब से निवेदन करूंगा, को आमंत्रित करूंगा कि वे आए एवं अखिल भारतीय अधिवक्ता परिषद का एक संक्षिप्त परिचय दें। श्री बघेल साहब।
सभी बंधुओं को नमस्कार, माननीय मेनन जी को नमस्कार। अधिवक्ता परिषद वर्ष 1992 से देश भर में काम कर रहा है। देश के प्रसिद्ध विचारक दत्तोपंत ठेंगड़ी जी ने अधिवक्ता परिषद का गठन 7 सितंबर 1992 को किया। आज वर्तमान में देश का ऐसा कोई प्रदेश नहीं है जहां पर अधिवक्ता परिषद सक्रिय नहीं है। अभी यदि देखा जाए तो देश भर का सबसे बड़ा अधिवक्ता संगठन अधिवक्ता परिषद। अब अधिवक्ता परिषद की स्थापना करते समय माननीय ठेंगड़ी जी ने विचार किया कि राष्ट्रहित सर्वोपरि रखते हुए विचारकों की दृष्टि से अनेक संगठन काम करते हैं, ठीक इसी तरह से अधिवक्ताओं के बीच में एक संगठन काम करे जो राष्ट्रहित की चिंता करता हो, राष्ट्र की बात करता हो, राष्ट्र के लिए काम करता हो, अपने व्यवसाय के साथ साथ समाज सेवा भी करता हो, और इसलिए अधिवक्ता परिषद का गठन हुआ। अधिवक्ता परिषद के मूल आधार जो हैं, वो अभ्यास मंडल अर्थात स्टडी सर्कल जो हम आज सुन रहे हैं। आज हमारे बीच में माननीय राजेंद्र मेनन जी न्यायमूर्ति उपस्थित हैं, उनका व्याख्यान हमको सुनने को मिलेगा। इसके माध्यम से, व्याख्यान मालाओं के माध्यम से हम अच्छे अधिवक्ता तैयार करें ताकि वे न्यायालय के समक्ष अच्छा सक्षम अपना उत्तर प्रस्तुत कर सकें, और इसीलिए अभ्यास मंडल स्टडी सर्कल हम चला रहे हैं। साथ ही साथ अधिवक्ता परिषद से जुड़े हुए सामयिक प्रश्नों पर भी समय समय पर अपनी चिंता व्यक्त करना और न्यायालय के समक्ष लाना। हमारे सामने उदाहरण है कि जब राम सेतु का प्रश्न उठा, जिसको तोड़ने की स्थिति बनी, तत्कालीन समय में हमारे अखिल भारतीय अधिवक्ता परिषद के प्रमुख लोगों ने माननीय उच्चतम न्यायालय के समक्ष अपनी बात रखी। फलस्वरूप आज पूरे देश भर में ये वातावरण बना कि राम सेतु की सुरक्षा होनी चाहिए और सुप्रीम कोर्ट ने ऐसा निर्णय दिया भी। ठीक इसी तरह से धारा 370 संविधान की, उसको अलग करने के लिए देश भर में मुहिम चलाई, उसका परिणाम हमको सामने देखने मिला कि गत वर्ष अगस्त के माह में संविधान की धारा 370 को लोकसभा के द्वारा समाप्त किया गया। इसके अतिरिक्त हम दलित, पीड़ित, शोषित और ऐसे समाज के उस वर्ग को जो न्यायालय तक नहीं पहुंच सकते या जिनको न्याय की प्रक्रिया के बारे में जानकारी नहीं है, उनके पास तक उस बात की जानकारी कैसे पहुंचे, तो अधिवक्ता परिषद पूरे देश भर में न्याय केंद्र चलाता है और उस न्याय केंद्र में सप्ताह में एक दिन बैठ करके हमारे अधिवक्ता बंधु जो अधिवक्ता परिषद से जुड़े हैं, वे ऐसे दलित, शोषित, पीड़ित या जिनको कानून का ज्ञान नहीं है, उनको कहां से उनको न्याय मिलेगा इसकी जानकारी नहीं है, उनको देने के लिए निःशुल्क सलाह देते हैं और पूरे देश भर में वर्तमान में न्याय केंद्र चल रहे हैं। अब इसके अतिरिक्त अधिवक्ता परिषद अपनी समय समय पर जो कार्यक्रम करता है, जिस प्रकार वर्ष 2018 में जबलपुर में राष्ट्रीय न्याय केंद्र पर कार्यशाला की गई थी, उसी तरह से प्रत्येक जगह समय समय पर अलग अलग स्थान पर होती रहती है। लेकिन हमारे साहित्य के माध्यम से हमारे अधिवक्ता परिषद की देश भर में चलने वाली गतिविधियों का आकलन कर सकें, अध्ययन कर सकें, इस निमित्त केंद्रीय स्तर पर हमारी इकाई एक पत्रिका जो चतुर्मासिक है न्याय प्रवाह के नाम से प्रकाशित करती है और उस न्याय प्रवाह के सदस्यों के पास भेजी जाती है। उसमें हम अधिवक्तागण अपने विचार दे करके छपवाने का कार्य कर सकते हैं। इस प्रकार हमारी कुल गतिविधियां अधिवक्ता परिषद की पूरे देश भर में चल रही हैं और आज हम ये जो सेमिनार कर रहे हैं, स्वर्गीय श्री पी सदाशिवन नायर जो वरिष्ठ अधिवक्ता इस उच्च न्यायालय के रहे हैं, उनका कुछ उल्लेख करना इसलिए भी आवश्यक है कि वो मूलतः श्रमिक संगठनों से जुड़े रहे और श्रमिक संगठनों से जुड़े रह करके उन्होंने अपनी सेवाएं जो प्रतिरक्षा संस्थान में थी उनको छोड़ करके अधिवक्ता का व्यवसाय प्रारंभ किया और एक सफल अधिवक्ता के रूप में जबलपुर में स्थापित हुए। उनके सम्मान में ये कार्यक्रम हो रहा है और एक विशेष परिचय इस बात का कि माननीय श्री राजेंद्र मेनन जी पी सदाशिवन नायर जी के भांजे हैं। इन सब बातों को कहते हुए मैं अपनी वाणी को विराम कर देता हूं। नमस्कार।
जी, ये थे हमारे बघेल साहब, बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद। आपने हमारे परिषद का एक संक्षिप्त परिचय हमें दिया। अब इस कार्यक्रम को आगे बढ़ाते हुए मैं हमारी युवा अधिवक्ता सुश्री तन्वी खरे जी को, जो कि मध्य प्रदेश उच्च न्यायालय जबलपुर में अधिवक्ता हैं, को आमंत्रित करूंगा कि वे आज के हमारे मुख्य वक्ता माननीय ऑनरेबल श्री जस्टिस राजेंद्र मेनन साहब का एक संक्षिप्त परिचय दें। तन्वी खरे।
गुड इवनिंग टू वन एंड ऑल। ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ अधिवक्ता परिषद, आई थैंक यू फॉर ऑनरिंग आवर इनविटेशन एंड टेकिंग आउट टाइम टू इम्पार्ट योर व्यूज अपॉन द टॉपिक and insight into service jurisprudence. We welcome you, sir. I would like to commence this session by introducing our chief speaker for this session, Honorable Sri Justice Rajendra Menon, presently chairperson, Armed Forces Tribunal. A brief introduction about Menon. Justice Menon was born in a district named Palakkad in Kerala. He did his move from Christchurch Boys Senior Secondary School, Jammu. He then pursued his graduation from Government Science College, Jabalpur, and later obtained a degree in law from MS Law College, Jabalpur. He started his career as a lawyer in the year 1981 under the tutelage of great eminent senior advocate late Sri P. Sadashivan Nair and senior advocate Mrs. Indira Nair. He was appointed as a standing counsel and for several private and public sector undertakings like Coal India Limited, South Eastern Coalfields Limited, Northern Coalfields Limited, Western Coalfields Limited, and various other establishments. And since then, we're looking back. Sir's journey from Bangalore started in the year 2002, when he was in the Madhya Pradesh High Court and later became a permanent judge in the year 2003. Sir was then appointed as the Chief Justice of Madhya Pradesh High Court in the year 2016. And also served as the Welfare Commissioner of the Bhopal Raj Bijli Compensation Committee. Sir, having served in the legislature as a judge for almost 14 years, was then elevated as the Chief Justice of Patna. Later, in the year 2018, Sir was sworn as the Chief Justice of Delhi High Court and demitted office on 6th June 2018. Sir is now presently the chairperson of Forces Tribunal and recently inaugurated virtual hearings to all its 10 regional benches. We are truly humbled with your presence today, sir. It is an honor and privilege to request my lord, Honorable Justice Menon, to address you. Sir, please.
Thank you so much, Tanvir, for such a nice introduction of our honorable speaker for today's evening. अब मैं इस कार्यक्रम को आगे बढ़ाते हुए हमारे मुख्य वक्ता माननीय जस्टिस मेनन साहब को आमंत्रित करूंगा, लेकिन उसके पहले मैं अपने श्रोतागणों को, जो हमारे व्यूअर्स हैं, जो ऑनलाइन व्यूअर्स हैं, जैसा कि आप सभी को जानकारी है कि हमारा आज का यह कार्यक्रम का सजीव लाइव ट्रांसमिशन जो है वो फेसबुक एवं YouTube पे हो रहा है। तो हमारा जो आज का विषय है, एन इनसाइट इनटू सर्विस ज्यूरिसप्रूडेंस, सेवा न्याय शास्त्र, एक अंतर्दृष्टि। इस विषय से संबंधित जो हमारे माननीय वक्ता महोदय जो हमें संबोधन करेंगे, उससे संबंधित अगर कोई भी प्रश्न हो आपका, तो वो Facebook और YouTube के कमेंट बॉक्स में लिखकर अभी आप लिख सकते हैं, और अंत में मेनन साहब के संबोधन के उपरांत हम उन सारे प्रश्नों को मेनन साहब के सामने रखेंगे और वो हमें जवाब देंगे। तो अब मैं बिना समय व्यर्थ किए आई इनवाइट ऑनरेबल श्री जस्टिस राजेंद्र मेनन साहब। सर, प्लीज एड्रेस अस। थैंक यू सो मच।
थैंक यू ब्रह्मदत्त। गुड इवनिंग टू ईच ऑफ द डिग्निटरी प्रेजेंट हियर। आई एम Indeed, indebted, and I thank the efforts of the Madhya Pradesh Adhivakta Parishad, Madhya Pradesh and Chhattisgarh Adhivakta Parishad, in having not only undertaken this task of having study circle to enlighten particularly the students and the junior advocates of the bar with various concepts and principles of law, and today having given me an opportunity to be amongst you and to address you on a topic that has been given to me. I am further honored by the Parishad for the fact that they have dedicated this lecture of mine in memory of my senior late Shri P. Sadashivan Nair, under whose guidance I learned the first principle of law, particularly the principles governing labor and industrial laws and the service law. Without wasting any further time on the formalities of introduction and other aspect, I think I should go to the subject right away. Now, The topic for today's lecture or deliberation by me is an insight into service jurisprudence. Service jurisprudence in the field of legal jurisprudence in all is a vast area. And when Mr. Sunil Gupta and Gyanen Singh Ji Baghel wanted me to speak on service jurisprudence, my question, first question to them was, what is the time allotted to me? And when they said it is 45 minutes to 1 hour, I said 45 minutes to 1 hour is not sufficient enough to address the students and the members of the legal fraternity on service jurisprudence. I'll at least need 6 to 7 such study circles and lectures to complete the subject. They have promised me that I'll be given more opportunity to deliberate on this subject, and therefore I'll be starting today with a short deliberation on the certain concept of service jurisprudence, which I will elaborate later on when I get more opportunity. Service, as we all know, is something by which we give some benefit or some act on our part, as a result of which we promote some interest and which gives happiness to us. But when it comes to rendering service on the basis of a contract, which is known as a contract of personal service, that service is rendered in the realm of a relationship which develops in that contract, which is known as the employer-employee relationship. Now, when a contract of service is entered into and the relationship of employer and employee is established, the contract may be of different type. It may be a contract based on the terms and conditions of the contract, purely a contractual service. It may be based on certain professional services to be rendered. It may be public service to certain establishments and institutes which qualify or come within the ambit of Article 12 of the Constitution. It may be a private domestic service. It may be statutory service where the service is rendered by virtue of some statutory requirement. Therefore, when we talk of a contract of service, we have to understand that it depends upon the nature of contract that has been entered into. In the realm of rendering of service, we have two types of service that are rendered. One is a service where the terms and conditions of service are governed by certain statutory provisions and constitutional provisions. And we have certain services which are rendered in the realm of private service, which are not governed by any statutory or constitutional provision, but which are governed by certain other legislative provisions, which in law has a separate jurisprudence, that is the legal and industrial jurisprudence. We will not go into that aspect of the matter. When we talk of service law, it is in the realm of a contract which has the tempering of a statutory contract or which is governed by the provisions of the Constitution, particularly Article 14, 16, 311, and the rules framed under Article 309 of the Constitution. Therefore, friends, today we'll be concentrating on the realm of contract entered into between a person who is the employee and an employer would be either a state within the meaning of Article 12 of the Constitution or an instrumentality of the state to whom the provisions of Article 12 of the Constitution applies. Now, when we talk of service and when we say that service commences with the creation of a contract of service between an employer and an employee, the first aspect that comes into mind in the matter of creation of a contract is the appointment to the service. And therefore, appointment to the service is the most initial stage where the contracts come into existence. Once the process of appointment is over, then comes various aspects pertaining to the terms and conditions of appointment, which would include the pay to be fixed, the other terms and conditions, including promotion, seniority, conduct rules, discipline, appeal rules, retirement, service conditions pertaining to leave, and various other aspects of the matter. And the service law in our country has developed to such an extent that each and every concept of service, right from appointment to retirement and the post-retirement benefit, have developed in such a manner that the case laws, the rules and regulations, and the concept have to be understood in a different manner. And therefore, today, I would begin with the first and the foremost concept of service jurisprudence, that is appointment to a service. Because it is appointment which creates the contract of service. We are talking about service in an establishment or an organization where the employer is governed by the provisions of Article 12 of the Constitution. And therefore, when we enter into a service, a person enters into a service with such an organization, he enters into public service. And when you enter into public service, the constitutional concept of Article 14 and 16 have to be complied with. There cannot be a contract of service in the realm of public service without meeting the requirement of Article 14 and 16 of the Constitution. Now, when we talk of appointments, as most of you know, have many facets. The appointment may be a regular appointment to a service or to a post. It may be a temporary arrangement. It may be an officiating arrangement. It may be an ad hoc arrangement, or it may be an appointment which is on a day-to-day basis, which we normally call the daily wages appointment. Thereafter, there may be appointment on a work charge establishment, or there may be a contractual appointment also. Each sort of appointment has a different connotation and a different concept based on the contract for which the appointment has been made. We need not go much into all those aspects of the matter. I'll straight away come to the legal aspect with which most of us are concerned in our day-to-day legal practice before the courts. As a member of the bench and as a member of the bar, we are concerned with the dispute that arise because of the concept of appointment and the intricacies involved in this concept. Normally, appointment to a service, particularly public service, has to be done by following the rules of appointment formulated under Article 3 of the Constitution, if it is public appointment to a service with the government, that is the central government or the state government. But if it is a service with an establishment which meets the requirement of Article 12, but is not a government or a government department, then the service is governed by the statute governing that establishment. For example, if you deal with the appointment of an employee of the Life Insurance Corporation, then the Life Insurance Corporation Act is the statute based on which the corporation is created, and the terms and conditions of appointment and other aspects pertaining to the appointment are governed by the rules framed under that statute. Similarly, you have employment with the public sector banks, the Reserve Bank of India, and all those establishments where the conditions of service are governed by the statute prescribed. And one of the most important aspects of prescribing a procedure for appointment to the public, to prescribing a procedure for appointment to public service is that it should meet the requirement of Article 14 and 16 of the Constitution. I'll come to that aspect later on. What has been seen is that normally, even though the mandate of law is that the appointment to public service should be made by following the rules and regulations applicable, for reasons which remain, for various reasons, non-availability of certain sanctions from the government, post not being sanctioned, the Public Service Commission not conducting the recruitment process, and various other administrative reasons result in regular appointment not being made. And therefore, there develops a concept of making stopgap arrangement, temporary casual appointment, ad hoc appointment. Now, these casual, temporary, and ad hoc appointments are made only for the purpose of meeting the emergent existing situation till regular appointments are made. But experience had been that these appointments, which are stopgap arrangement and temporary in nature, continue for years together. Regular appointments are not made. The employee continues for years, and the main litigation pertaining to the appointment aspect of service dispute is the regularization of service or the benefit claimed by these temporary ad hoc or stopgap arrangement appointments made, claiming benefit, service benefit based on the contract of employment, which is applicable only to a regular employee. There the problem starts, and when these litigations started coming, if you trace the history of these litigations, you will find that the courts started granting benefit to persons on the ground that they have worked for 3 years, 5 years, 10 years, and therefore they should be deemed to have been appointed to a particular post and the benefit granted to them. Various judgments are there covering various aspects. Some of the judgments say that no, these are illegal appointments, benefit should not be granted. Some applied the principle of equal work for equal wages. Some applied the principles of equity. Some applied the principles of Article 14. And ultimately, when there were conflicting judgments and benefits being granted in different manner by different courts to employees who are inducted into service, divorce the normal rule of recruitment, the matter came to the Supreme Court, and in the year 2006, a constitution bench of the Supreme Court decided the issue in the famous case, which is now known as Uma Devi 3 versus the Secretary of State of Karnataka, 2006, Volume 4, SEC, page 1. I have come straight to this judgment for the simple reason that shortage of time prevents me from taking you through the history of more than 35 cases which resulted in the Supreme Court reconsidering everything by creating a constitution bench on a reference made by a three-bench judge, that also in the case of Uma Devi itself. If a student of law or a junior member of the bar wants to understand the concept of appointment, the constitutional scheme governing appointment, my advice to them is read this judgment of the Constitution bench, and everything will be clear as daylight to you after you go through this judgment. This is a judgment where the Supreme Court has not only discussed the various aspects pertaining to appointment, but it discusses the aspects of appointment in the backdrop of the constitutional requirement. Even the basic theory of the basic structure theory of the Constitution, as laid down in the case of Keshwan and the Bharti, and an elaborate discussion on the Keshwan and Bharti case is made in this judgment. And finally, because this judgment, this dispute in the Uma Devi case arose with regard to regularization of service or absorption of service of temporary or ad hoc appointee, the Supreme Court deals with this issue in the backdrop of the constitutional requirement, not only the basic structure, but Article 14 and 16 of the Constitution. The Supreme Court classifies appointment in this judgment into two categories: irregular appointment or illegal appointment. The Supreme Court says that what can be regularized is only an irregularity. If it is an irregular appointment, it can be regularized. But if it is an illegal appointment, there is no question of regularizing an illegal appointment, because an illegal appointment is violative of the procedure and the requirement of Article 14 and 16 of the Constitution. The Supreme Court emphasizes that in this country, there are crores of employees. Employment is one of the biggest problems facing the country. People are waiting in the queue for an advertisement to be issued, for a recruitment process to be conducted, and enter into public service. When that is the situation, then permitting illegal appointment through backdoor entry and regularizing that service would be violative of Article 14 and 16 of the Constitution, and it cannot be permitted. And therefore, the Supreme Court goes on to say that if a person has been appointed illegally, if the appointment is illegal, then even if he has worked for 20 years, 30 years, or 40 years, no sympathies can be shown to him. He has to be shown the door, and he has to make room for the persons who are waiting in the queue so that they are appointed in accordance to the requirement of the law, particularly the Constitution. But at the same time, the Supreme Court says that even if the mandatory requirement for appointment to a service, namely the recruitment rules or the laid down procedure for recruitment, has not been followed, but the appointment is preceded by following some procedure that is known to law, then such an appointment, even if it does not meet the complete requirement of the rule, may be classified as an irregular appointment, and a consideration for regularizing the service of such irregular appointment can be made. But the Supreme Court says that even if the irregular appointment has been made, the irregular appointment has to meet most of the criteria laid down for appointment to the post. Now, I'll give you some example. For example, appointment is to be made to a post of teacher, and the University Grant Commission and the rules governing appointment prescribes an education qualification, certain experiences, and certain other criteria pertaining to age. An appointment made divorce all these criteria would not be a regular irregular appointment. It would be an illegal appointment. An irregular appointment would be one where, if the rule says that appointment to this service shall be undertaken after due process of selection conducted by the Public Service Commission. Now here, for years together, the Public Service Commission has not conducted any recruitment process. As a result, the university followed some process of appointment, advertised the post, called for applications, scrutinized the applications, and those applications which met the requirement of the rule, if after following a process of selection, which may be a written test or an interview, if the appointment has been made, even though the strict rules of recruitment has not been followed, but the appointment having been done by a process known to law, the Supreme Court says this would fall within the realm of an irregular appointment and it can be regularized. Likewise, for all other appointment, an irregular appointment is one where we say that some process known to law has been followed. The appointment precedes some process known to law. It's not an appointment which we call as a backdoor entry into the service. A backdoor entry into the service is an appointment by nepotism, by not following any process known to law. Somebody in some department calls you from your house, appoints you without calling for any application, without following any process of selection, and having entered into the service by using the backdoor entry process, you work for 10 or 15 years and then you say, my services should be regularized. The Supreme Court says, no, this is an illegal appointment. The bare minimum requirement of following a process known to law has not been followed. It's violative of Article 14 and 16 of the Constitution, and therefore such an appointment cannot be regularized. So, dear friends, if you read the judgment of Uma Devi and thereafter from para 53 onwards, after having classified appointments into these categories, the Supreme Court says that as a one-time measure, every department should constitute a high-level committee, and all employees who have completed 10 years of service as on the date of the judgment, which was sometime in October 2006, every appointment should be scrutinized and an evaluation done to find out as to whether the appointment falls in the category of irregular appointment or illegal appointment. If it's an irregular appointment, a recommendation can be made for regularizing that service and such an employee can be regularized. Now, when it comes to disputes with regard to regularization, a petition is filed and the grievance of the employees, I have worked for 20 years, my juniors have been regularized, many persons appointed along with me have been regularized, I have not been regularized, and therefore I should be granted the benefit of regularization. If the matter comes to a judge like me, the first question that I would ask the counsel representing the petitioner would be as to how were you born in the department? Tell me how your birth took place in the department, and then we'll proceed with the case. And if the process of birth in the department comes in the realm of an illegal appointment, he has to go home. Otherwise, the considerations can be made. Now, you will find many judgments subsequent to Uma Devi. I'm not referring to many of the judgments which are there, because it would be just reading the judgment and wasting time. On the contrary, I try to put my point through as a teacher speaking to a student in the most simplest language I can use. When you seek regularization into service, the first and foremost aspect pertaining to your pleading should be, this is how I was born in the department. I came to know by an advertisement in the newspaper that some appointment process is going on. I applied. My application was scrutinized. I was subjected to some process of selection. I fulfill most of the conditions required for appointment. I have been appointed, and therefore I should be regularized. If that be so, he has a case. But if he's silent, does not utter a word anywhere in the pleading as to how he was born in the department, the signal goes that he has been called from his house and the post given to him in a silver platter. That violates the mandate of Article 14 of the Constitution, and therefore such a person does not get any relief. When you analyze the judgments of the Supreme Court and various high courts post Uma Devi, you will find that in some of the judgments, the Supreme Court has followed a principle of molding of the relief. Molding of the relief means when the court comes to the conclusion that injustice has been done to somebody, substantial justice has to be done, then the molding of the relief has to take place because the employer did not use the discretion available for condoning some of the shortcomings which led to the appointment being not regularized. For example, there may be a case where a person has worked for 20 years and at the time of his initial engagement or his birth in the department, he may have been overage by 1 or 2 years. And the committee constituted under the judgment of the Uma Devi may say that because his initial appointment was beyond the age prescribed for recruitment under the recruitment rule, it's an illegal appointment, it cannot be regularized. Here, the court will look into the rules, and if it finds that there is a power for relaxation in the rules by the competent authority, or the candidate fulfills all the requirement of law, then the molding of the relief is adhered, is given effect to, and it is said that in this case, the court may hold the appointment to be an irregular appointment and grant relief to that person. As a judicial officer and as a member of the bench, you see, when I am talking to you and when I am giving lecture, I do feel that I should share certain experience with each of you. And therefore, please bear with me if I have deviated from the subject and tried to explain you something which I feel should have been told to you, or which is, in my view, important to be conveyed, particularly to the junior members of the bar. When the Madhya Pradesh High Court was celebrating the Golden Jubilee celebrations, the then Chief Justice, Justice Patnaik, decided that we should have lectures by eminent jurists in the principal bench at Jabalpur and various benches, at least one every month. And I was directed to go along with my brother judge, Justice Samvat sir, to meet Justice Ravindran and invite him to come to Indore bench and give a lecture in memory of late father of Justice Samvat sir and Madam Vaghmare, Justice Vaghmare, who is no more. When we went to Justice Ravindran, he said, yes, very good. I have been the Chief Justice of Madhya Pradesh. I'll come. He was the Supreme Court judge, sitting judge of the Supreme Court. And we said, sir, can you give us the topic on which you would be giving the lecture? He said, my topic of lecture is, do we sit back and look? I looked at Justice Samvat sir. He looked at me we did not understand anything. He told me, just put this as the subject and I'll come and give a lecture and all of you would enjoy. A judge of the Supreme Court who had been our Chief Justice said so. Therefore, we as disciplined soldiers listened to what he said, came back to Justice Patnaik and told him, sir, he is coming on such and such day and he will give a lecture. The topic of the lecture is, do we sit back and look? Justice Patnaik laughed at it, said, what is this subject? People would ask us, what is he going to talk? What will we tell them? We told him, sir, this is what he has told us. And he said, it will be a very interesting lecture, particularly for the members of the judiciary, namely the judicial officers. When he came and he started the lecture, people asked him on his arrival itself, sir, what is the topic? And he said, it's a suspense. Listen to what I speak. And he spoke for 3 hours. And do you know what he told us? He told us that as a judge, when certain case comes to you, after going through the facts and the file, you know that injustice has been done to him. Injustice has been done to some person. And it has to be rectified. And when such a situation arises, you don't sit back and look, but you exercise all the discretion available to you under the law. Find out what can be done to do justice to this person. And that is what you have to do. You have to find out what inherent powers are available to you. Are there provisions as which permit you to utilize your inherent powers? Take action and impart justice. And that is what he said, that we don't sit back and look, but we have to ensure that justice is done. And that is why I say, if you read the subsequent judgments of the Supreme Court after Uma Devi, you would find that in many of the cases, the Supreme Court has tried to dilute the requirement and the stringent views given in Uma Devi only for the purpose of dispensing justice, molding the relief, because the judges felt that we cannot sit back and look when injustice is being done to you. So that was about the concept of appointment, regularization, and certain aspects pertaining to the most important judgment of the Supreme Court in the case of Uma Devi, which I thought should be one judgment which I should share with each one of you, because I felt that many of the lawyers who appear not only in Madhya Pradesh but even in Patna and Delhi were not aware of what was the intricacies and the ratio of the law laid down by the Supreme Court in the case of Uma Devi. When we talk of appointment, I can speak on various other modes of appointment. Like, there are judgments which would say that even promotion to a post is an appointment. There are deputation, and deputation is also a mode of appointment, and there are various laws pertaining to that. We will go to all those aspects if Baghel Saab permits us on a subsequent date to permits me to be with each one of you and address you on those issues. But when I am talking of appointment, another important facet of appointment, which forms the basis for litigation, is compassionate appointment. Now, as you all know, and I have just now said, that appointment to a public service has to meet the requirement of Article 14 and 16 of the Constitution. But compassionate appointment is an illegal appointment. An appointment devolves the rule. An appointment which is violative of Article 16 of the Constitution. And if you feel that you should be enlightened on this, I suggest and recommend to you that please read these two judgments. General Manager State Bank of India versus Anju Jain, 2008, Volume 8 Supreme Court, page 475, and State Bank of India versus Somveer Singh, 2007, Volume 4 SEC, page 788. In both these cases, apart from this, many other cases are there. Even there is a judgment of the full bench of the Madhya Pradesh High Court, of which I am the author. It's a judgment of 2010, and I think it's a case pertaining to Bank of Maharashtra, where the full bench of Justice Deepak Mishra, Justice K.K. Lahoti, and myself have dwelled on to various aspects of compassionate appointment. And there also, it has been said that compassionate appointment is an appointment violative of Article 16 of the Constitution. It is deposed the rule and is granted strictly in accordance with a particular scheme formulated by the government or the establishment concerned. You see, why is a compassionate appointment termed as an appointment illegal or violative of Article 14 and 16? Because, as we discussed, the concept of irregular appointment and illegal appointment in the case of Uma Devi, compassionate appointment is also an appointment where the rules of appointment into public service are not complied with, where the requirement of Article 16 is not complied with. On the contrary, it's a concept where a system of hereditary reservation to seek public appointment is introduced. And therefore, it is said to be an appointment which is not normally permissible under law. But at the same time, social justice, sympathies and various other factors come into play, and when the breadwinner of the family is no more, the family suffers because of the financial crisis that falls on the family due to loss of the breadwinner. A state, a model employer, cannot keep quiet, sit back and look. They have to rise to the occasion and do something to tide away the crisis of the family, which has fallen due to the unforeseen situation arising out of death of the breadwinner. And therefore, the concept of compassionate appointment, an appointment on the basis of compassion, on the basis of sympathy, was developed. And for that purpose, the law permitted the government and the employer to formulate a scheme for compassionate appointment. And therefore, compassionate appointments are normally undertaken based on a scheme for compassionate appointment. Certain provisions are laid down in the scheme, and the appointment has to be made strictly in accordance to the requirement of that scheme. One of the most important dispute in the matter of compassionate appointment is as to which scheme should be made applicable when the question of compassionate appointment arises. Whether the scheme that was applicable at the time when the employee died should be made applicable, or a scheme should be made applicable which was in existence at the time when the appointment is taking place or the application for compassionate appointment is being considered. In the case of compassionate appointment, we will find that there are many cases under many schemes and policies formulated. There are provisions which contemplate that if a child or the person who is entitled for appointment is a minor cannot be appointed, then he can be appointed when he earns majority. There are various things. people do not file applications in time. Even if applications are filed in time, the government or the establishment sleeps over it. The appointment is not made, and in the process, different schemes come into play. And therefore, one of the most disputed aspect of compassionate appointment is as to what should be the scheme applicable for determining a case of compassionate appointment. And I need not bother you very much with all these things, because Supreme Court has laid down that whatever be the scheme applicable, the scheme which was in vogue at the time when the employee concerned expired, that scheme, subject to any modification in the scheme brought about retrospectively, would be the scheme based on which the appointment should be made. And this is a judgment of 2020, which is, the citation is India Bank versus Promila, 2020, volume 2 SEC, page 729. And recently, 10 days back, on 29th of September, a bench of the Supreme Court, headed by Justice Sanjay Kishan Kaul, decided a case on an appeal filed by the state of Madhya Pradesh. It is State of Madhya Pradesh versus Amit Shrivas. The judgment has not been reported, but I had the occasion to see the judgment in live law. And this judgment follows India Bank and says that subject to any amendment which has been given retrospective effect, the compassionate appointment has to be made in accordance to the scheme that was in existence when the employee expired. So that is one clear legal principle settled in the matter of compassionate appointment by the Supreme Court. There are various judgments of the Supreme Court with regard to compassionate appointment, mostly dealing with the concept of delay being a ground for non-grant of compassionate appointment. Many a times you would find that compassionate appointments are claimed after 10 years, 15 years, 11 years of the employee having expired, and certain reasons are given for the delay. The consistent view of the Supreme Court had been that compassionate appointment is granted to tide over the financial crisis that had fallen on the family because of the loss of the breadwinner. And if for all these 10 years, 12 years, 14 years, the family could survive, then what is the purpose of granting compassionate appointment to this family? For the simple reason, because compassionate appointment is not a matter of right. It is an appointment, as I said, divorce the statutory rules of recruitment. So there are rules governing compassionate appointment. The schemes are there. Most of the banks have a scheme of granting compassionate appointment. And in their scheme, you will find that it is based on the financial benefit that accrues to the family after death of the breadwinner. It says that if the family is receiving such and such amount or such and such percentage of his salary by way of settlement of his financial claim after the death, such a family will also not get compassionate appointment. So dear friends, what I am trying to emphasize is that as far as compassionate appointment is concerned, it's not a right available. It's a beneficial scheme which has been introduced on social consideration, sympathetic consideration, and therefore in the matter of compassionate appointment, you should be guided by the scheme of compassionate appointment. And there are series of judgment on compassionate appointment, which I had made a note of it, but I don't think the time would permit. I have already shot my 45 minutes allotted by the organizers. I had also thought that I would today cover certain aspects of appointment and certain principles of natural justice, which is important for the purpose of service law. But I feel that the time allotted to me was 45 minutes. I have crossed it, and therefore, even on the subject of compassionate appointment, if the notes which I have prepared were to be completely read over and told to you, it would have taken at least 1.5 hours. So, dear friends, please bear with me. I promise you that whenever I get a chance, when this pandemic of COVID-19 is over, I'll come to my dear friends, the junior members of the bar, and physically discuss various aspects of service law with you, because you are the persons who are going to take the baton from all of us, and the institute and the development of law now rests with all of you. And therefore, I want that the junior members of my bar, my high court, should be well equipped in various aspects of law, so that my high court continues to be one of the best high courts in the country. Thank you very much. Jai Hind.
Sir, thank you so much, sir. That lecture indeed was giving an insight into the service jurisprudence, rather. बहुत ही बारीकियां आपने सर एड्रेस करी हैं सर्विस ज्यूरिसप्रूडेंस की, और हमारे श्रोताओं ने, जो व्यूअर्स हैं, दे हैव बीन वेरी कीनली गिविंग देयर कमेंट्स एंड आस्किंग क्वेश्चंस. सर, देयर आर सेवरल क्वेश्चंस, बट इन व्यू ऑफ द लिमिटेड स्पैन ऑफ टाइम व्हिच वी हैव विद अस, सर, आई विल बी आस्किंग अ फ्यू ओनली. ही
सर, यस यस ब्रह्मन, इट्स अप टू यू. आई एम एट योर सर्विस.
सर, एक क्वेश्चन जो है वो प्रवीण यादव जी ने पूछा है. मिस्टर प्रवीण यादव हैज आस्क्ड दिस क्वेश्चन, वेदर कंप्लायंस ऑफ सेक्शन 17B व्हिच इज स्टॉप्ड आफ्टर अटेनिंग द एज ऑफ सुपर एनुएशन, इवन इफ एम्प्लॉई इज फेसिंग हार्डशिप्स प्रॉब्लम्स बिकॉज बीइंग आउट ऑफ एम्प्लॉयमेंट. सो जो धारा 17 भी, ऑब्वियसली ही इज रेफरिंग टू इंडस्ट्रियल डिस्प्यूट्स एक्ट.
सर्विस ज्यूरिसप्रूडेंस डील्स विद एम्प्लॉयमेंट टू पब्लिक सर्विस मेनली, एंड व्हेन इट कम्स टू प्राइवेट सर्विस द ज्यूरिसप्रूडेंस इन लॉ चेंजेस. And for that, you have the industrial and labor jurisprudence. We have more than 40 to 50 labor legislations. And now the government has come with 3 labor codes. I think it has received the assent of the president. And now the terms and conditions of employment and the service jurisprudence, as far as the private sector and the industrial are concerned, they are governed by the industrial law, and therefore your question was on a subject which is not connected with service jurisprudence, but it is connected with labor and service jurisprudence. But still, because you have asked, I have to answer it. Now, if you read section 17 of the Industrial Dispute Act, it says that when a person has been dismissed from service and the labor court or the industrial tribunal has directed for his reinstatement, and if an appeal has been filed by the employer challenging your reinstatement, then pending the appeal, because you are either to be reinstated, and if you are reinstated, you continue to work and earn your wages for the service rendered. But if you are not reinstated, then as a matter of subsistence allowance, certain benefit has to be granted to you. That is the provisions of section 17B. Now, this Section 17B is in the nature of a subsistence allowance, which is granted to you in lieu of reinstatement for the period when the matter is pending in a high court or before an industrial tribunal or a higher court. Now, you see, you are entitled to work and earn your wages so long as the contract of service exists. The moment you are superannuated, the contract of service comes to an end. And once the contract of service comes to an end, you are not entitled to get any benefit under Section 17B because you cannot be employed after the contract of service comes to an end. And therefore, in my personal view, the benefit of Section 17B cannot be granted to a person who has superannuated.
He may
claim that because I have been reinstated, certain post-retirement benefit like gratuity or provident fund or all those things should be granted to me because I am not being reinstated because the employer has gone to the court. But he cannot claim 17B because 17B is something which is granted to you as a subsistence allowance in lieu of reinstatement for the service not being taken from you for which you are entitled to. So that is my answer, and I have answered it extempore without referring to, I don't know if any judgment has come because I have not dealt with 17B for the last more than 3 years.
Yes, sir. Sir, fine, sir. So the court may very well mold the relief in
mold the relief and say, yes, grant him certain percent of gratuity amount subject to final decision, take some undertaking from him, grant him some benefit, release part of the provident fund amount to him, or if there is a provision for pension, 17B can be granted as a substitute for pension.
Sir.
The pension can be granted as a substitute for 17B.
Sir, fine. Sir, yes. One of the topics you addressed was on compassionate appointment. तो सर एक कंपैशनेट अपॉइंटमेंट से संबंधित एक प्रश्न पूछा गया है श्री जितेंद्र कुमार बेन जो हमारे न्याय केंद्र प्रभारी भी हैं अधिवक्ता परिषद न्याय केंद्र चलाता है जहां पर गरीब लोगों को मदद दी जाती है उनको तो जितेंद्र बेन जी पूछ रहे हैं कि क्या कंपनसेशन देने के बाद कंपैशनेट अपॉइंटमेंट का अधिकार समाप्त हो जाता है सर प्रोबेबली ही इज रेफरिंग टू एक्स ग्रेशिया सर सो वेदर द राइट टू कंपैशनेट अपॉइंटमेंट क्लोजेस on grant of compensation or ex gratia, sir?
Now, it will depend upon the scheme. If the scheme says that in lieu of compassionate appointment, you will get such amount as ex gratia, then once you accept the amount, then your right for compassionate appointment goes. If I recollect, in the state of Madhya Pradesh, there is a provision that you may claim compassionate appointment or in lieu thereof, the family will continue to get salary for a period of 5 years. So the moment you go in for salary for the period of 5 years, then your right to compassionate appointment goes away because the government feels that all these posts which are available should be filled up by advertisement requiring after fulfilling the requirement of Article 16. Therefore, once you under the scheme opt for an ex gratia payment or a compensation, in my view, the right for compassionate appointment is forfeited. You waive that right.
Sir, there is a provision that in case vacancies are also not available, even in that
not
case,
available, then also yes, that also there. There also you have an option either to wait till the vacancy arises, keep your right reserved till the vacancy arises. But once you take the compensation, you lose waive your right.
Yes, sir. And if we do not accept it, there is a chance we may lose ex gratia as well as
that also. That also, yes. Durghatna se der bhali.
Sir, one of the questions is asked by Shri Akshay Pawar that what is the difference between providing permanent status to an employee and regularization of an employee and what is a permanent establishment?
I would advise him to read the judgment which I referred to, which was delivered by Justice Sanjay Kishan Kaul on 29th of February, that is State of Madhya Pradesh versus Amit Vishwas. There, Justice Sanjay Kishan Kaul has referred to certain rules of Madhya Pradesh and he says that grant of permanent status is a status granted to you because of certain rules. For example, under the standing orders, which is applicable to an industrial establishment, if you work for a particular period, you get the status, permanent status. And the permanent status gives you certain benefit with regard to working hours, salary, overtime, etc. But that doesn't mean that you are regularized. And Justice Sanjay Kishan Kaul has held this also, that a permanent grant of permanent status under a particular rule Particularly, that was the case pertaining to work charge employment. He said, grant of that permanent status does not mean that you are getting regularized into government service.
Sir, there was one judgment of Ram Naresh Rawat as well in that regard.
Yes. So, because permanent status granted is only a protection granted to you. For example, once you get a permanent status, your services cannot be terminated without giving you notice or an opportunity of hearing. Those are some of the benefits.
Yes, sir. Sir, one of the topics your good self addressed was on Uma Devi irregular illegal appointments. तो मेरे मन में एक सवाल था और ये एक सवाल नीरज ठाकुर जी ने भी पूछा है. मैं थोड़ा सा मिक्स करके दोनों को पूछता हूँ. फॉर इन वी मे टेक अ हाइपोथेटिकल केस दैट अपॉइंटमेंट हैज टेकन प्लेस लॉन्ग बैक एंड नाउ द एम्प्लॉई इज एट द मिडिल ऑफ हिज सर्विसेज और एट द वर्ज ऑफ रिटायरमेंट. तो नाउ इफ द अपॉइंटमेंट जैसे मनसुख लाल सराफ करके एक सर जजमेंट हुआ था जिस डीवी का ऑफ द ऑनरेबल हाई कोर्ट ऑफ मध्य प्रदेश जिसमें कि ये बोला गया था रीओपनिंग ऑफ ऑल द अपॉइंटमेंट्स व्हिच हैव बीन इलीगली डन नॉट इन अकॉर्डेंस विद द प्रोसीजर. सर हाउ फार इज इट जस्टिफाइड व्हेन एन एम्प्लॉय इज एट द वर्ज ऑफ रिटायरमेंट टू रीओपन हिज ही हैज स्पेंट मे बी 15 इयर्स और मे बी 30 इयर्स इन सर्विस एंड नाउ तलवार उसके ऊपर लटक रही है कि उसकी सर्विसेज में कम टू एन एंड. सो वेदर सच ओल्ड केसेस शुड बी और ऑट टू बी रीओपन सर.
Now, Brahmadat, if you read Uma Devi, and there is a particular para where it says that if it's an illegal appointment, the time lag from the date of appointment till now, even if it is 20 or 30 years, should not come in the way of the court in holding that it is an illegal appointment. Article 16 has to be followed. But these are cases where the court should examine the case in the backdrop of what is the illegality in that particular process of appointment vis-a-vis this person. And if the court feels that substantially compliance has been made, for example, I find Neeraj Thakur having given a question here where he says that an appointment was made 12 years ago without advertisement, but than one candidate on the basis of interview was appointed. Now, it is not necessary that an advertisement should be issued. There are cases where the a notice is fixed on the notice board of the department ki hamare yahan itne appointment ki zarurat hai, aap darkhast dijiye, aur usme kuch log aa gaye aur usme selection ho gaya. Those appointments have been upheld. So some process known to law has been followed. It's not you have been called from your house and given. And if this Neeraj Thakur's query, which I am seeing on the screen, I would say that yes, this is a regular, this can be classified as a regular appointment subject to his fulfilling most of the requirement of the recruitment rules.
Sir, as you said, facts need to be seen. तो उसमें ये भी देखना चाहिए कि गलती किसकी थी. It was an overtake. हाँ, employer जैसे यहाँ पर नीरज ठाकुर जी बोले.
When you see, therefore, when in dealing such cases, that is why I gave you the example of Justice Ravindran's concept of do we sit back and look? No, you don't sit back and look, but these are the cases where you should go in and find out ki is the employee responsible for what has happened. If he is not responsible, he is not party to any misrepresentation or fraud, he in good faith thought ki humko bhi interview leke appointment kiya hai, the benefit should go to him. These are things which the court should rise to the occasion and do justice to a person.
Yes, sir. Sir, questions are बहुत ढेर सारे हैं लेकिन समय की सीमा मर्यादा को ध्यान में रखते हुए तो हमें आपका साथ ये बना रहेगा as my lords have assured us that this the sessions would continue.
Yes, yes, sir. I assure you, I have told Mr. Baghel and Mr. Sunil Gupta also that as and when you feel that I should come, I'll always be there.
Sir. थैंक यू सो मच. तो सर अब हम कार्यक्रम को समापन की ओर ले जाते हुए हमारे सुनील गुप्ता जी जो माय लॉज हैव आल्सो रेफर्ड टू हिम क्वाइट अ फ्यू टाइम्स जो जिला इकाई के सचिव हैं मैं उनको आमंत्रित करूंगा कि वे आए एवं आभार प्रदर्शित करें.
बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद बरमदर सिंह जी. आज हमारे बीच में माननीय न्यायमूर्ति राजेंद्र मेनन जी आए और उन्होंने सर्विस लॉ का जनरल पे लेक्चर दिया जिसे सभी अधिवक्ताओं ने सुना, उसके लिए हम बहुत आभारी हैं राजन मेनन साहब का, और मैं अनिल खरे साहब का भी बहुत बहुत आभारी, हमारा अधिवक्ता परिषद जिनने इंट्रोड्यूस कराया और मेनन साहब को बड़ी सरलता से हमारे इस कार्यक्रम में आमंत्रित किया गया, और अखिल भारतीय अधिवक्ता परिषद के हमारे दीपेन जी कुशवा जी जो कि हमारे मध्य क्षेत्र मंत्री भी हैं, और मोहित जी जो इस कार्यक्रम को ऑर्गेनाइज कर रहे हैं उनका बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद। हमारे कार्यक्रम में महाकौशल प्रांत के अध्यक्ष श्री ज्ञानेंद्र सिंह बघेल जी जो कि हमेशा हमारे इस स्टडी सर्कल के कार्यक्रम में बड़े सहयोग देते हैं और जब भी उन्हें आमंत्रित किया जाता है बड़े सरलता से हमेशा उपलब्ध रहते हैं, उनका भी अधिवक्ता परिषद बहुत बहुत आभार व्यक्त करता है। और इस कार्यक्रम को जो देख रहे हैं हमारे सभी अधिवक्ता यूट्यूब और फेसबुक के तहत से, जिनके कारण हम लोग के उत्साह बढ़ते जा रहा है और हम ऑनरेबल जस्टिस मेनन साहब को और आगे भी इसी सीरीज में सभी को आमंत्रित कर रहे हैं इस कार्यक्रम में। ये केवल आपके कार्यक्रम को देखने के कारण ही और इसको जो कमेंट्स हैं और क्वेश्चन आ रहे हैं क्यूरी आ रही है इसके कारण से इसको हमेशा बढ़ाया जा रहा है, इसलिए सभी अधिवक्ता परिषद आप सभी लोग का व्यूअर्स लोग का बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद करते हैं। और इस कार्यक्रम के सभी जिला मध्य प्रदेश और छत्तीसगढ़ और इवन सभी अखिल भारतीय अधिवक्ता परिषद के पूरे भारत में देखा जा रहा है, उसके प्रांत अधिकारी जिला अध्यक्ष एवं शशि एवं समस्त अधिवक्ता के कार्यकर्ता को बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद जिन्होंने इस मैसेज को प्रसारित किया और सभी लोग तक पहुँचाया जिससे सभी लोग हम उस कार्यक्रम में जुड़े, और विशेषकर हमारे जिला इकाई जो जबलपुर की जिसमें हमारे प्रांत अधिकारी सतपाल चढ़ार, राम मिलन प्रजापति, जितेंद्र बैन और सीमा साहू मैडम, नितिन कुशवाहा स्टडी सर्किल प्रमुख और हमारे मीडिया प्रभारी सचिन अग्रवाल जी के सहयोग से हम ये कार्यक्रम बड़े सरलता और सुलभता से कर रहे हैं, और सभी का धन्यवाद। और मेनन साहब का फिर से एक बार बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद जो आपने इस कार्यक्रम में आए और इस कार्यक्रम की शोभा बढ़ाई।